terrified, stage fright. Why do you need a boy who's a brilliant reader? Annie asked the man. Because I have just lost two fairies, he said. He pointed at Jack. You can read both, and you are nuts, said Jack. Will Bai see you around, he said. He nudged Annie to move along. Wait, wait, she said. She turned to the man. What do you mean my brother can read both fairies? Read them where? Two boy actors didn't show up today to play fairies, said the man. But your brother reads with such a passion, he can save us all. Jack stared at it. Was this guy saying what he thought he was saying? You mean you want Jack to be in your play? Said Annie. Indeed, said the man. There are 3,000 people here today, waiting to see the play I have written. We cannot disappoint them, can we? 3,000, said Jack. Yes, said the man, and one of them is the most important person in the world. No, no way I can't do that, said Jack. He had never liked being on stage. He always got stage fright. Wait, wait, Jack, said Annie. She turned to the man. You need two fairies, right? Yes, said the man. Well, Annie tilted her head. Her voice went up. I can read too. Yes, let Annie do it, said Jack. She's a great reader. She can be both fairies. Ah, but of course Annie cannot go on stage, the man said kindly. Why not? Asked Annie. The man raised his eyebrows. Sure you know it's against the law for girls to go on the stage, he said. Boys must play all the girls' parts. But that's not fair, said Annie. Indeed, it's not. But we can't not change the law now, said the man. He turned to Jack. So, Jack, will you join our players? No thanks, said Jack. He tried to walk off, but Annie grabbed his arm. Wait, I think I know what Jack wants, he said to the man. He will only be in your play if I can be in it too. No, that's not what I want, Annie, Jack said under his breath. But Jack, it will be so much fun, she whispered. And there's nothing to be afraid of. You got to read your part. You don't have to memorize it. Jack could tell that Annie really, really wanted to be in the play. And it was definitely a way to keep her mind off the bear. Oh, okay, he said, sighing. He looked at the man. I'll be in your play. If Annie can be in it too. The man looked at Annie. She smiled eagerly at him. The man smiled back. Why not? He said. But Annie will have to pretend to be a boy. She can tuck up her hair and we'll call her Andy. Yay, thanks, said Annie with a grin. A trumpet blasted inside the theater. Hot, the play begins, the man said. He took Jack and Annie by the hand. My name is Will, by the way, he said. Come on, come along, Jack and Andy. We are super shadows. Chapter 6. On stage. Will led Jack and Annie through a door into the back of the Globe Theater. Then he led them up a dark stairway. As they headed upstairs, Jack heard laughter coming from the audience. His legs were like jelly. This way, said Will. He led Jack and Annie into the crowded, dimly lit room. Actors were rushing about everywhere. Each seemed to be in his own world. One was putting on a cape. Another was tying a rope around his waist. A third was whispering words to himself. I'll find your costume, said Will. As Will dug through a large basket of clothes, Jack and Annie looked around the costume room. It was carmined with fancy gowns, purple and blue capes, gold and silver wigs, stacks of hats, hats, and masks. Cool, whispered Lenny. She touched a donkey mask and a lion mask. These would make good disguises, huh? Jack was amazed. She was acting so calm. Didn't she know they were about to stand in front of 3,000 people? The thought made him break into a sweat. His stomach felt fluttery. Here, said Will. He handed them green tunics, hats, and slippers. Police on, no time to dally. Your pots come up soon. Jack and Annie slipped behind the curtain and changed into their costumes. As they put on their hats, Annie hid her pigtails. When they came out, Will handed them each a small scroll. Here are your rules, he said. They have only your lines on them, no one else. Jack unrolled his scroll. He had two long speeches to read. Wait a second, he said. I thought I just had a few lines. I didn't know I had a ton. Don't worry, said Will. Just remember, speak very clearly and with feeling. And above all, act natural. Act natural? Said Jack. How do you act natural when you're about to have a heart attack? Just then a short, chubby man burst into the costume room. He had curly hair and bright red cheeks. He was dressed all in green, too. For goodness sakes, Will, he said in a frantic whisper. Well, will we do? Don't worry, look who I found. They both can read, said Will. He pushed Jack and Andy forward. Jack and Andy meet Puck, Merry Wonder of the Night. He'll take you to the stage. Good luck. Annie smiled. Jack groaned. Come on, boys, said Puck. Follow me. Puck led Jack and Annie out of the costume room into the hallway. Then he guided them to a dark area at the back of the stage. Actors stood silently nearby, waiting to go on. One wore a beautiful white gown. Others were tattered brown rags. Through an arch, Jack saw the roof of the stage. It was blue with stars and the moon. A huge crowd stood directly in front of the stage. More people watched from the galleries above.
Galleries
above. Every single person in England is out there. Jack thought in a horror. How did I let Annie talk me into this? I'll take you on stage first, Puck whispered to Jack. When I say, how now, spirit? Will wonder you start reading your lines, understand? Jack barely nodded. His mouth felt dry. He tried to swallow, but he couldn't. Puck turned to Annie. You go on stage with the fairy queen, he whispered. He pointed to the actor dressed in a beautiful white gown. When she tells you to sing her to sleep, you start your song. What's the tune? Asked Annie. Just make it up, said Puck. Now, if the yellow sings, don't stop. If who yellow sings, Jack broke in. The groundlings got a bit wild, he said Puck. Groundlings, said Jack. The rowdy folk who don't have seats, said Puck. They are standing close to the stage. If there's a lot of food, don't stop either. Just keep going. That does it, said Jack. He couldn't go on stage. Not with groundlings throwing things. Not with 3,000 people watching. Not with a million lines to read. And not when he was about to throw up. While Puck and Annie watching the show, Jack slipped away. He looked for the exit. Just as he found the stairs, he bumped into Will. What are you doing? Will whispered. I can't stay, said Jack. I'm sick. Will sucked in his breath, but then he put his hands on Jack's shoulders and spoke calmly. Close your eyes for a moment, Jack, he said. Jack closed his eyes. He could hear his heart pounding in his ears. There's nothing to fear, Will whispered. Imagine you are a fairy. You are in a forest on a summer night. See the silver moon overhead. Hear the owls. Hoo, hoo. Well, deep whispers seemed to cast a spell over Jack. He felt calmer. He could picture the silver moon. He could hear the hooting of the owls. Are you in a forest on a summer night? Asked Will. Jack nodded. If you believe that, the audience will believe it too, whispered Will. Will, whispered Puck. The chubby actor ran to Jack. He grabbed his hands and pulled him along. Before he knew it, Jack was on stage.